Bob was afraid I was going to drop the award, I think. Thank you very much for those overly generous remarks, and good morning to you all. And I do not really know Senator Durbin, but I was certainly inspired by his remarks. I do have the pleasure of knowing Steny Hoyer very well, and he does a terrific job as the Democratic whip in our side of the Capitol, the House of Representatives, and before that as the Majority Leader of the House of Representatives. Will you please join me again in thanking these distinguished leaders? We do meet in an historic building and in an historic room. First of all, the building, named for Richard Russell, the distinguished United States Senator from Georgia, who was an advisor to presidents in the 20th century, a close advisor to Franklin Roosevelt and Harry Truman, and an extremely close friend to Lyndon Johnson. And as you know, Dick Russell was on the Warren Commission after the assassination of John Kennedy. And while his views and my views do not coincide on issues of race, they certainly coincide on the fact that he advised Lyndon Johnson to be very wary of entering a land war in Asia, and I commend to your attention his full biography. And then, of course, we meet in what has been designated the Kennedy Caucus Room for all three of the Kennedy brothers who served with distinction here in the Senate: John Kennedy, Robert Kennedy, and Edward Kennedy. And so many historic events have occurred in this room. And that continues today, ladies and gentlemen, because your being here is an historic event. Senator Durbin indicated three short stories regarding his advocacy and how he came to a great appreciation of the arts. I will simply give you one. We are lawyers in New Jersey, and among our clients were the family, the heirs to a great American artist, Robert Henri. And there will be many in the room who will know Robert Henri, the leader of the Ashcan School of Art at the beginning of the 20th century. I think he died in the late 1920s. He wrote a wonderful book, The Art Spirit, that is still used in research and academic concerns across the United States. His work is displayed in all of the great museums in this country, the National Gallery, the Met, and others as well. It is through my learning about him when I was a child that I first developed an appreciation for the arts. I'm pleased to be here with the U.S. Conference of Mayors. And let me say that mayors are on the front line of democracy across our nation. And to those of us who serve at the federal level, we honor with respect those who serve at other levels of government, the state level, the county level, and the municipal level. Ladies and gentlemen, will you join me in thanking the United States Conference? When the award is presented to me in another room, I will display it with pride over in my office in Rayburn, and you're certainly welcome to come into my office. As has been indicated, I don't decorate exclusively with photographs of myself on the walls of my office, and you're welcome to come into the office to see the things that we have, and certainly this will be among them, and I thank you for the award. But really, I think that the award should be given to everyone in this room. Because of your efforts, we prevented funding cuts to the National Endowment for the Arts, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and other federally funded art programs, including Corporation for Public Broadcasting. I am the Republican chair of both the Arts Caucus and the Humanities Caucus in the House, and Jane comes and visits me regularly and is always welcome. And Chairwoman Chu, I think we should all commend you for the tremendous work you've been doing. I do make the fiscal point to my Republican colleagues in our conference and on the Appropriations Committee that investing in the arts is a worthy federal expenditure. I try to convince them with statistics. The nonprofit arts industry generates at least $135 billion in economic activity and supports over 4 million full-time jobs. For every dollar the United States spends on federal arts initiatives, 9 non-federal dollars are leveraged. This is an enormous benefit financially. But of course, it goes well beyond that, as both Senator Durbin and Congressman Hoyer have indicated. A month before his death, President Kennedy, John Kennedy, in October of 1963, went up to Western Massachusetts, Amherst, at the groundbreaking of what became the Robert Cross Library. Still exists. Incidentally, the portrait of Robert Frost in that library was painted by James Chapin, a painter I knew when I was a child, the great American portraitist James Chapin, and it is the Chapin portrait of Frost that hangs in the Amherst Library. Kennedy stated on that beautiful, crystal clear October Saturday morning that art establishes the basic human truth which must serve as the touchstone of our judgment, that the artist becomes the last champion of the individual mind and sensibility against an intrusive society and an officious state. And that is as true today as it was in 1963, which I guess is 55 years ago. Art nourishes the roots of our culture, and we must let the artist follow his vision wherever it takes him. That is our mission in the Congressional Arts Caucus and in the Congressional Humanities Caucus, to build a culture that motivates the artist to his or her greatest potential and strengthens the fiber of our national life. I am honored and pleased to be with you this morning. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.